Hello, aspirants. Looking at current affairs for 24th July, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these nine. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, finally compensation for women in Orisha's village of widows. So in this Orisha village in Koinjar district, what is seen is that men here have died. There are widows. Their breadwinning male members have died due to a disease called silicosis. And this is a preventable occupational lung disease. So these members of these families were actually employed by a mining company, which is Jharkhand based, which was mining pyrophyllite. So this is the ore which was being mined here. It had a mining lease which was executed in 1982. So the male members from this Madaranjaga Jodi village, they had started working in this mining unit, and because of what they were working was that this pyrophyllite was ground to powder here. So because of this, they were exposed to silica, which results in silicosis, which is an occupational disease. And here, because of the intervention of NGO, an Angul based NGO had moved the National Human Rights Commission, which had ordered an investigation, and only after NHRC's initiative, that and district administration initiated an investigation, and there were around 50 male deaths which were linked to silicosis as such, which were identified as such by the NGO, but the investigation found only 29 death cases as directly linked to silicosis. And finally, the award which has been provided, so 16 families are going to benefit because of this award of 46 lakh as compensation ordered by a labor court in Orisha. So this is the news. So here you can see this is silicosis, an occupational lung disease which affects the lungs and eventually leads to death as well. So here this is pyrophyllite, which is a versatile mineral which is mined in many cases and suitable for, you know, white ceramics and other products like fiberglass, plastics, paints, etc. too. So it is generally also used as an alternative to talc and soapstones as such. Then the next news item is once hero, now white elephant. So this is regarding INS Wagli. So this is actually a submarine which has been decommissioned and it is docked in your Chennai port. So it's docked at Chennai port, and the Tamil Nadu government had proposed to establish it as a museum, a submarine museum. So this was the proposal under Chief Minister Shiva of late Jayalalitha of Tamil Nadu, that in June 2012 it was decided. But till now no action has been taken. Actually it was planned that it would be placed at Mamallapuram, which is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. So near the Shaw Temple in Mamallapuram, it would be placed here at the coast. But then the contractor who was commissioned to take this INS Wagli to this temple platform had taken it to, and after that it realized that it does not have the capacity to place it on top of that platform. So then it had to be brought back to Chennai coast. So this is the entire venture which took place, which has now been highlighted by the CAG report as such. So here this is the detail given about INS Wagli. So there's only one submarine museum presently, which is in Vishakhapatnam. This is the decommissioned submarine INS Kursura. So this was supposed to be the second submarine museum, but then even the officials here of Tamil Nadu had visited INS Kursura to study it so that they can plan their own submarine museum with INS Wagli, but then it seems that did not work. Even in 2015, a petition was filed in Madras High Court that this is a huge scrap placed in at Chennai port, and this may invite lightning as well and it can result in a disaster. But the Madras High Court dismissed this petition and said this is a purely administrative domain, we cannot do anything about it. Even during the cyclone Vartha, the submarine was almost damaged when the Chennai coast was affected by the cyclone in December 2016 lately. So this is there. Also, CAG highlights that the entire process of taking the submarine and then bringing it back, it has resulted in an expenditure of rupees 4.41 crore without any substance in it. No result has been come out of it. So this is because of lack of proper planning, it states. So this is mentioned in the CAG report. Also, you should know about Mamallapuram and the Shaw Temple here. So this is Mahabalipuram or Mamallapuram, as it is called, the city of Mamalla, which is the name of the great Pallava ruler Narasimha Varman I, who had initiated this architecture of show temples, Rath temples, which are built by with a single rock. So, single rock cut temples are located here. So, these are the monolithic temples of Mahabalipuram, which are specifically known for these Raths, the five monolithic Raths which are there here. This is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Shah temple is near the coast here too, you can see. So it's a five-storied structural Hindu temple of South India. Then the next news item is CAG flags delays in work on culverts. So this is regarding the indigenously built anti-submarine warfare culverts which we are developing. So these are being indigenously developed by GRSE, Garden Reach Shipbuilders and Engineers Limited, a public sector undertaking. And it has been highlighted that the Navy and GRSE has delayed this entire project, and the approved designs were amended 24 times till as late as last year for these culverts. So these are anti-submarine warfare culverts as such. So it is said that against the 18 weapons and sensors which had to be installed as such, they were not delivered. Only two as such were delivered, and they were not fitted with the weapons and sensor systems which they should be fitted with. So there are actually four of these anti-submarine warfare culverts. They have been named here. I have given the details. It's under Project 28. It is the Kamortha, INS Kamortha, INS Kadmat, INS Kilton and INS Kavarat. So only Kamortha and Kadmat have been delivered so far. The other two anti-submarine warships are not yet delivered. So they have been delayed, and the result is, the reason which has been highlighted here is that the Navy did not give the clear specifications of what is its requirement. So it had only given an initial naval design as such given. But then, and the Garden Reach Shipbuilders and Engineers Limited started work. So this letter of intent issued in March 2003 gave only sketchy specifications, no details. Details came by from Navy finally in 2006. And after that, it made major modifications till 2008. So that's what is it, that when the Navy does not give its details specifically and keeps on changing its requirements and brings in modifications, then of course the cost will go up. So original sanction was of 3051 crores. It went to 7852 crores because of these major design modifications. So this is what the CAG highlights. It says the first culvert was delivered in July 2014. So this is INS Kamortha, which is spoken of, and INS Kadmat, which was delivered in November 2015. Actually, third and fourth should have been delivered by 2014 and 15, but they have not been delivered. So this delay is being highlighted by the CAG. It also says that harbor acceptance tests are still pending for the second covert, that is INS Kadmat, and also it says that the sea acceptance test has been done on, as such, on 6 weapons and 10 sensors in the first covert are also pending satisfactory completion. So even in the first covert and second covert, both we are seeing that tests have not been completed yet. So this is the status as such of these covets in the Indian Navy. So the third and fourth one will be named INS Kilton and INS Kavarati, and all these are named after island regions in our Andaman and Nicobar group of islands and Lakshadweep islands. Kamortha is actually in Andaman and Nicobar. Kadmat, Kilton and Kavarati. Kavarati is the capital of Lakshadweep island. So other three are from Lakshadweep. They are named after these regions in these islands. So this is there. They are stealth covets designed and built indigenously. So they have stealth capabilities as such. Then the next news item is Russia keen on selling MiG-35 jets to India. So Russia has now given its an indication that it wants to sell MiG-35 fighter jets, the fifth generation fighter jets, which it claims is far more superior than Lockheed Martin's F-35. So they are now proposing, it says that India has also given its interest in this MiG-35, which is successor to MiG-29. And many MiG fighter jets have been used by India as such for the last 50 years. So this is regarding the fifth generation fighter jet, which is specifically known to have stealth technology. And it can function at super cruise and super cruise speeds as such too. Then the next news item is Assam, Bengal, Gujarat face deluge. So there are floods going on in Assam, where the death toll has now gone up to 76. Bengal also, there are heavy rains and many rivers here like Shilapati, Dwarka are flowing above danger mark. Even in Gujarat, there are heavy rains expected and flooding in various districts. Even Godavari River is flowing above danger mark too, and there have been alerts which have been kept initiated in various regions in Maharashtra as well. This is there, floods being seen in various regions in the country. Then the next news item is forum concerned at secret RCEP talks. So we have been speaking about Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement, and here the talks which are going on in Hyderabad now are secret talks. So this aspect is being highlighted by various civil society activists. They say that why these talks have to be secret? Why can it not be out in the open? When the results are going to benefit the people, then why the negotiations cannot be out in the open? Even defense related negotiations, even for that matter, they say nuclear disarmament negotiations also take place in the open. So why, with respect to economic trade, what is the secrecy? So such questions are being raised here. And plus they say that the norms which are leaked out, that what they are discussing is going to have adverse consequences. One, data exclusivity we already discussed with respect to intellectual property rights. The other provisions are also specifically mentioned here, which we have mentioned earlier times too. So here you can see one will be liberalizing investment norms as such, which it is planning to initiate the RCEP FTA, which would be finalized. So here it would reduce import duties on goods or bring down barriers on goods and services as such too. So these 16 nations RCEP, which has been negotiated, these 16 nations together account for 40% of world's GDP, and India is also included here. So it will impact various sectors like agriculture, services, medicines, investments, e-commerce, as we have discussed earlier too, concerns with respect to e-commerce too. So other things which are highlighted here, it says, are even some countries which are demanding market access, like for milk products, Australia and New Zealand are demanding market access. It would affect India adversely. They also say the investor state dispute settlement mechanism, which India is against and has excluded it out of its model BIT, that this is the final stage as such which you can initiate investor state dispute settlement mechanism through international arbitration. So this is also under negotiation. So these are the concerns being raised by the and with respect to e-commerce also we have already discussed. So these are the activists' concerns. Then next is melted fuel found in Fukushima reactor. So this is regarding Fukushima Daiichi nuclear reactor, where the disaster struck in 2011 because of a tsunami and the earthquake, because of which on Richter scale, around 9 on Richter scale. So this huge earthquake resulted in the power supply being switched off for these reactors and explosions taking place, and huge amount of radioactive water entering into the water bodies to oceans too. So these were the concerns here. And post this, it has been stated by Japanese government too that the process of cleaning operations as such will take place over decades. So even presently too, it says that it will take at least 4 decades because radiation levels are quite high, so operations go slow. So this is there. It is said to be the second worst nuclear accident post Chernobyl of 1986. So Chernobyl reactor disaster also, we'll see what was that too. So here on Japan's northeastern coast up here, where this Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster broke, because the tsunami as such knocked out the power supply and the cooling system. So this resulted in the core melting and the disaster struck. So here evacuation zone has also been initiated by Japanese authorities, and USA recommends much more of an evacuation zone than that. But Japan is also a populated, densely populated nation as such. The death tolls, though the government does not give the exact figures of people who have died due to these radiations, but then you can see the death tolls as such per 1,000 evacuees, the 2010 line and 2011 line shown, number of deaths taking place. So this clearly shows the details of deaths also increasing. And this is regarding the Chernobyl disaster, which is called the worst nuclear reactor disaster in the history. So this actually struck in present day Ukraine. Earlier it was under Soviet Union, and this is said to be at level 7 of the international nuclear event scale. So it has at a very high level, which no other disaster has reached. And this Chernobyl reactor disaster actually took place because they were undertaking a test. So they were testing that if power supplies cut off, then what would happen? Because in Fukushima Daiichi, we saw because of the tsunami, the power supply got cut off. But here the power supply was there, but they were testing that if power supply is cut, then how the backup power is working. So in testing that, the backup power fell too low, and it resulted in the concentration of, because it requires power. Because what is nuclear reaction basically? Why is power supply important? Because nuclear reaction, if fusion reaction or fission reaction, as nuclear reactors have fission reaction taking place. If a nuclear reaction is left uncontrolled, then that is what it is. It is a nuclear bomb, which is an uncontrolled fission reaction. It will explode. But if the nuclear reaction is controlled, so that will result in it being used for generation of electricity. So when power supply is not there, then the fusion react, then the nuclear reaction, nuclear fission reaction cannot be controlled. So then it goes out of hand and it results in a huge nuclear disaster. So this was the nuclear disaster which struck in Ukraine. The next is Iran-Iraq signed pact on military cooperation. So we have already been discussing about how Iran and Iraq have come closer, and now this is a military cooperation agreement which the two countries have signed as such to fight against terrorism and extremism. And of course, it is not to the liking of US. So West, Iran-Iraq, as we saw, they have come closer after 2003 US invasion of Iraq, when Saddam Hussein's regime, which was anti-Iran, was brought down. So Iran is also a Shia country, and here also in Iraq, we have Shia majority now. The government in power is led by Shia Muslims. So this is there. So President Trump has raised his concerns against all, specifically even Syria, Yemen, Iraq, all these are aligned to Shia fighters and along with Iran. So these are concerns raised by Donald Trump to a growing Iranian influence in these conflicts in these regions, supporting Shia fighters. Then the last news item is MPC members to get 1.5 lakh per meet must disclose assets. So government has three appointees in the Monetary Policy Committee. This is the decision which has been taken. The first meet took place, and as such, and they decided the rates, the key policy rates, that's the repo rate basically, in October 2016. So since then, they have been meeting once in 2 months. So bi-monthly meetings are taking place. It is mandated that they should meet at least 4 times in a year. But till now, they have been meeting bi-monthly. And now the RBI has come up with a notification, and government has announced that it will pay 1.5 lakh per meeting along with air travel and other reimbursements to the three government appointees in the Monetary Policy Committee. For the RBI members, it is stated that they have recently received a pay hike. So there is no mention about benefits for RBI members. Three are from RBI, three are government appointees. So these appointees would get these benefits, plus that is also mentioned that they have to observe a silent period 7 days before and 7 days after the rate decision is taken to uphold utmost confidentiality. So this is there. Of course, silent period and confidentiality requirement also apply to the three RBI members, though these perks are not provided. So this is that they are not mentioned as such. So also they have to be mindful of any conflict between their personal and public interest, because they are part of Monetary Policy Committee. So their interaction with any profit making organization or their personal financial transactions, they will have to notify, they have to be careful about them too, ensuring that there's no conflict of interest. They have to give annual returns also as such. So this requirement has also been brought forth now, that they have to provide their annual returns, which will be updated as such continuously. So this is there. About MPC, you should already know everything. Presently, they have stated that there can be emergency meetings also called within 24-hour notice. Also, there can be technology-enabled arrangement meetings at shorter period. Meetings can also be called. So this is there. And disclosing assets and liabilities annually will also take place. And the pay hike which RBI members have got is shown here. The RBI governor has got a doubling of their basic salary. So that has gone to 2.5 lakh per month now. And even deputy governor is 2.25 lakh per month. So RBI governor Urjit Patel, deputy governor Viral Acharya and executive director MD Patra are the three members from RBI in the monetary policy committee. And three members from as government appointees have been appointed for a four-year term are also shown here. These are the three government nominees as such. So this is there. Of course, the objective of this monetary policy committee is to control inflation. So inflation targeting, that it should stay at 4% plus minus 2%, means in the band of 2 to 6% is what they have to ensure. And recently we saw that inflation went below 2% for the month of June, but that is also called a transitionary inflation level. So we'll have to wait till the next bi-monthly meet of RBI, of MPC takes place as such. And voting rights, each member has one vote, and in case of a tie, the RBI governor has a vote as such, he votes in case of a tie. And decisions are taken by majority. Many decisions we have seen have taken place by consensus, all have agreed. In the last meet when repo rate was not changed, one of the members had dissented. So this is there. So this inflation targeting is the main objective as such. And also that it is mentioned that if monetary policy committee is not able to meet its target, then it has to submit a report to the government detailing the cause of the failure of achieving the required target. So this report goes within 1 month from the date on which the bank has failed to meet the inflation target. So these conditions are also there. So these are the news items. Thank you.